Pamela Schoenfeld says, is there a potential for adverse effects for someone who supplements with 5 or 10 milligrams of folic acid or methylfolate based on a heterozygous MTHFR SNP? Is there a potential? Yeah. The tolerable upper intake level for folate was set at 1 milligram on the basis that there are rare hypersensitivity syndromes that have caused reactions to 1 milligram or higher, and on the basis that folate has been, in numerous case reports, supplementation of more folate than that has been the factor that appears to precipitate the neurological degeneration in B12 deficient patients. So it seems like if you're B12 deficient and you add a megadose of folate, there might be something causal about adding the folate precipitating the B12 deficiency. And that makes sense. You know, you like folate and B12 participate together in methylation. The neurological degeneration specific to B12 deficiency is probably mostly due to the non-methylation functions of B12. That's why it doesn't happen in folate deficiency. So if you add folate, you're going to probably redirect some of the B12 into the methylation pathway, rob it from the other pathway, which is metabolizing methylmalonic acid into the citric acid cycle. And you do that and you provoke the specific neurological degeneration of B12 deficiency. So, you know, but the flip side of this is someone could say, well, there's no evidence that outside of these rare things that 50 milligrams of folate causes harm. And that's true. There is no well-characterized harm from it. But I still think that it's stupid. It's stupid. Why would someone with a heterozygous MTHFR SNP need 10 milligrams of folic acid or methylfolate? That makes no sense biochemically at all. It makes no sense. So first of all, are they compound heterozygous or are they just heterozygous for the SNP? Pam says they're overreacting, but it's hard to override an MD. Okay, so we're not overriding the MD. We're talking about this theoretically for the people who want to do things that make sense. So first of all, they're heterozygous. Does that mean they're compound heterozygous for both MTHFR SNPs? Because if they are, then that's meaningful. It's like a 50% drop in methylfolate production. If they're heterozygous for the H1298C SNP, then that's like about 15-ish% decrease in activity, which is very small. It's very small and is probably not of much meaningful impact. But let's assume that it's a meaningful impact. I mean, let's assume that this person is the worst case scenario. They've got, so they're homozygous for C677T. Maybe they have a reduction in the folate transporter, MTHFD1, the other enzyme that precedes MTHFR. Like maybe there's a few things going on and they're going to be, their methylfolate levels are going to be really decreased. So, for people who don't know my view, go to chrismasterjohnphd.com/methylation, where I have this all laid out. And for people who do know my view, I don't want to go into too lengthy of a rant because I know you know this, but what's going on there? Well, you recycle a molecule of folate 18,000 times a day. And that means that if you have a 75% decrease in that recycling, that means that you're missing out on 13,500 recycling events. Can you make up for that by consuming a higher dose of methylfolate? To do so would require that you consume 4.5 grams of methylfolate. When you do that, what happens? Well, you supply all the methyl groups, but guess what? Now you have 13,500 times more folate molecules than you would have had. So you've made up for the methyl groups, but you've done so by providing thousands of times more folate than you should have. What happens when you do that? I don't have a damn clue, but I'm not going to do it. And I'm not going to advise anyone else to do it. And I think anyone else who does it is crazy. But beyond that, if it takes 4.5 grams of folate to do that, then what on earth are you going to achieve by taking 10 milligrams? So you're taking ridiculously excessive folate levels to achieve orders of magnitude less than what you would need to take if your theory about what to do about the SNP made any sense. In other words, it's impossible to fix an MTHFR SNP by taking extra folate. It makes zero sense to do that. And 10 milligrams is both arguably unsafe from too much folate and orders of magnitude less than what you need to actually do what you think you're doing by taking it. So there is no context in which it is in any way rational to fix even a bad MTHFR situation with high dose methylfolate. No sense. Meanwhile, what do we know from human trials that happens when you have MTHFR lowered? We know that it doubles your choline requirement to 900 to 1200 milligrams a day. We have human studies on that. Do we have big ones? No. Do we have lots of them? No. We have two small human trials showing that it doubles your requirement for choline. Do we have any trials of using 10 milligrams of folate? No, right? So we have zero evidence, zero rationality backing up high-dose folate for MTHFR. Meanwhile, we have decent small trials, number of two, not two people, two trials that are small that do something that makes tons of sense, makes perfect physiological sense. Those trials say we double the need for choline. Why would you double the need for choline? Because if you're not as good at methylating with folate, what do? You methylate with choline because you are good at it, right? So it's like the biochemistry says you would do that. The human trial says that it happens. That's the only thing that has human trial evidence behind it to do for MTHFR. The only thing is to increase choline supplementation. The only thing. Even everything else I say to do is based on rational reasoning of the pathway and not on human trials. So choline is the one thing backed up by human trials. But what does rational reasoning about the pathway tell you? Well, it tells you that, number one, even if you supply choline as an alternative methyl donor, you're still going to have low methylfolate levels. And so you do want to get methylfolate into your system. Why? Because methylfolate doesn't just methylate. You're fine with just methylating when you get enough choline. What you're not fine with is you don't have normal methylfolate levels. And why do you need methylfolate? Because it doesn't just methylate. Methylfolate is the off switch for the glycine buffer system. What's the glycine buffer system? The glycine buffer system is when you use glycine to get rid of extra methyl groups. The system is designed to use methylfolate as the off switch for that system when you don't have enough methyl groups. And that means that if you can't make methylfolate, you don't have that off switch, which means that even when you don't have enough methyl groups, you will still lose them by methylating glycine. That causes you to lose methyl groups, and that causes you to lose glycine. And so you want to put some methylfolate in there, and you want to keep it there. How do you keep the first of all, how do you make sure it's there all the time? You spread out your methylfolate evenly across all meals. Second of all, how do you make sure that you don't use it up real quickly and get rid of it, since you don't have a way to keep it there by recycling it? Number one, you supply the alternative methyl donor. If you double the choline like the studies say you do, not only do you not waste choline, but you make sure that you have a constant influx of methyl groups so you don't have to use the methylfolate. Number two, you reduce your methylation need. The best way to do that is to take creatine, because 45% of your methylation is to make creatine. If you take creatine, you have the potential to cut your methylation demand almost in half. The other thing that you do is you say, well, okay, I am conserving my methylfolate. I'm putting methylfolate in. I'm conserving it by supplying the alternative methyl donor. I'm conserving it by reducing my demand for methylation, but I still might not have enough methylfolate there. And so I will lose glycine as a result of that. So you replace the lost glycine. Those are the things that make rational sense based on everything known about the biochemistry. And when I say known about the biochemistry, I'm not saying known about what enzymes exist and what they do, which is the level at which a lot of people reason with. So actually, this is a great point. You cannot reason about the biochemistry. Just look at me, put my glasses on like this helps me speak more powerfully. you cannot reason about biochemical pathways just knowing what the enzymes are and what they do. You have to take into account the kinetics, which means how much of something happens relative to another thing, and what are the contextual factors that change those calculations. And we have very good mathematical analyses of the kinetics of the interactions of all the enzymes in the methylation pathway. And so someone can say, take methylfolate so that you can methylate your genes to silence certain things from expressing. And they're wrong. Why? Because the kinetics of the methylation pathway say that within the context of normal physiology, the supply of methyl groups has no effect on DNA methylation. And so DNA methylation is irrelevant except in extraordinary deficiency or excess states because of the kinetics of that enzyme, because of the math involved, right? And so it makes rational sense when you ignore the math to say, oh yeah, like we don't have enough methylfolate, let's just pound methylfolate in the pathway. It's the math, right? It's the math of the biochemistry. It's how many times do you need to add a methyl group to that folate molecule in a day? And does it make any sense to take 10 milligrams? It's the math that tells you that makes zero sense, right? And so there was Bill Lagakos tweeted once, and I don't know if he's the origin of this saying or if he was quoting someone else. He tweeted once, biochemistry is what can happen. Nutrition is what does happen. And I wouldn't put it exactly like that, but the point that he's making, I endorse, which is if you just look at the biochemical pathway in a textbook or in a paper that's just showing you the enzymes and what they do, that doesn't tell you jack about how it works because not all those things are, you know, not all those things are altered in the way you would expect when you're deficient in something. You have to take into the account, how are things prioritized? How does the supply of one thing mathematically affect the other? Right? And so when you take into account the math, the rational explanation of what you need with MTHFR is what I just said. Double the choline, take creatine if needed to decrease the methylation demand. By the way, I neglected to mention the newest thing I added, which is make sure to get the riboflavin to reverse the effects of the polymorphism. But assuming that the riboflavin is not fully effective at reversing them, it's double the choline, take the creatine if needed to decrease the dependence on the pathway, spread out the methylfolate across the day, and then make up for any lost glycine. That's what the math says. So, look, I don't know if it's harmful, but it's irrational to take high-dose methylfolate for this purpose or high-dose folic acid. It's irrational. It's on the basis that it's not effective, and it is 5 to 10 times the Institute of Medicine's tolerable upper intake level. And so, you know, it's not that I know it will cause harm. It's just that it's way into the territory of what has the possibility of harm in some people. And so why, for no benefit, would you take yourself deep into the territory of possible harm? And rant. So Marcus follows up Yes, I really appreciate these extensive explanations. Pamela says, me too, this is fantastic. Okay, thank you. I'm trying to use an intuitive sense of when it would make sense to rant on the basis of the question at length, and it looks like it's working. So thanks.